Got it. Yeah. Okay. So, and I should finish by what, one by 6:45 or 6:50?
Wish. 30:45. As you wish.
30. Okay. 30:45.
Yeah,
okay. Like are that. You guys ready?
Yes.
Okay. Do you hear me?
Yes, we can hear you.
You hear me? Great. Okay. Well, I want to welcome you all to coding, or maybe I should say hacking Dürer. In fact, I have a nickname for this event, hacking art history, or making art history exciting again. And I'm very sad that I'm not with you in person, because you know I work a lot with these amazing people who organized this event and also started the International Journal for Digital Art History. Unfortunately, I couldn't come because I'm finishing my next big, you know, book from IT Press, and they gave me a deadline to finish by the end of April, so I kind of have to stay home and do that. So I thought about what I can do, and I know that the kind of goal of this gathering is not to give more lectures, right? When you have live streaming and you know you have meetups and you know, there is a 50 billion blogs. What we want to do is we want to get together and do things, right? So what I'm going to do is not talk about theory separately, but actually show you a bunch of different projects we have done in my lab since 2008. So I have a lab called Cultural Analytics Lab, which is both kind of focusing on the analysis of data sets or data which represents our visual culture, in particular contemporary visual culture, you know, things like Instagram, you know, or visual culture of web, but also you know, historical artifacts as well. So I'll show you a bunch of projects and you know try to make short comments to illustrate also various kind of conceptual but also practical possibilities what you can do. Right, and I want to kind of communicate in my talk this kind of hacking right attitude, or rather maybe it's attitude which is more typical for digital designers, you know, interaction designers, you know, web designers, visualization designers, artists, you know, where you start, you know, just playing with something. And this idea, like, let's get some data and start playing with and see what comes up. I think it's very, very different when attitudes in the academic humanities where when you get a grant, you get your students, you get your assistants, you think about it. When you publish an article, and by the time you publish an article, nobody cares, right? So I think we should bring some of this more kind of playful, let's get something done, let's get something interesting done in a few hours attitude to humanities. Not all such projects will be amazing. Most of them will be complete crap. But it's just about kind of getting your hands dirty and doing things. So I'm going to switch to my slides, so you will not see me, but hopefully you'll still hear with me. Okay, so let's see. Okay, here we go. Okay, let me just see. Okay, let's go. Okay. Okay. You guys see it?
No, that's.
We see. Okay, wow.
We see our image right now. Right. Oh, full screen, okay. We see it.
Okay, now you see full screen?
Yeah.
Okay, great. So I have maybe 40 minutes, so I'm going to skip a lot. So, perfect. Okay, so the first project, so basically my favorite projects, right, are the ones which maybe take a weekend. So I found if we're working on something which is a few thousand images, you can do it sometimes in the weekend, sometimes you can do it in the evening. If you're working on something which is you know, millions of images or more, it usually takes 6 to 8 months. So this project was actually done by a student, undergraduate student in my class. I've been teaching these topics as a professor of digital art at UCSD, University of California, San Diego, since 2006. That's maybe like from project from 2010, 2011. I pointed out to students that one of many data sets available online is millions of pages from hundreds of American newspapers, which have been digitized and made available by the Library of Congress, and these pages can go back to 17th century. Students working, I always have students working in groups, so about 6 to 7 students, you know, got a group. We figure out how to kind of download the data from Library of Congress using API, and they downloaded, you know, high-resolution images of pages from few newspapers. Even my student did this thing like in a week, and when he first told me about this idea, I thought it was complete nonsense, but it actually turned out to be great. So I'm going to start this project because I think it shows the power of visualization, and it shows you how, in fact, you don't need to quantify, you don't need to count to analyze data, right? So if your data is images or perhaps spatial forms, right, you can use visualization to reveal interesting, meaningful patterns without ever counting or measuring something, right? So one idea which I want you to question immediately, that digital humanities or digital art history is about counting. It's not. So let me play a video. So it's basically a front page, a front page of a particular newspaper, which was published in Hawaii, Hawaiian Star. So he took a front page of every issue for about 20 years. And these pages are just animated, right? Very quickly, very aligned. Here, our publication appears on the left. 1894, 1895, 1896. It's a kind of pre-modern visual communication, right? It's mostly text-based. We don't have big images. We don't have hierarchy. So it's really designed for slow reading. And when you'll see very quickly how a kind of modernity and modern graphic design and modern visual communication will appear, right, within a couple of years. So 1901, right, it's still very kind of sort of not really very aggressive, right, not very organized. Not even 1903, we can see suddenly, right, we can see big headings, we can see big images. So we can see the emergence in this case, right, in this case of a newspaper, of the most important principle of modern visual communication, which is hierarchy of information, right? So not only we have images, but we have big headings which grab your attention, and your kind of attention is now being organized. Even once, you know, we go to 1907, 1908, doesn't change much, right? So in this case, in the case of a particular newspaper, we can see how this change, you know, happens very quickly. It doesn't happen overnight, right? It still takes place a few years. So I call this kind of visualization example of explorative media analysis, where we have some media data set, and we don't ask some research questions, right? We basically start with exploring it, visualizing it. And once we visualize it, we may notice some patterns. So here we notice, for example, changes, right, in size of headings, composition, page organization, use of images. Notice these patterns, we can actually go and measure these characteristics, even plot them, even analyze them, even interpret them. But first, we have to see. Now, this is another news media. I apologize because probably some of you know this project from our lab. So this is every cover of Time magazine for 86 years, 1923-2009. And in this case, we organized in a single grid, right? So the covers go kind of left to right and top to bottom. So this is a close-up upper left, upper right corner, which corresponds to 1920s. And that's a close-up of a lower, right, lower corner, where you have 2000s. When I look at this visualization, right, I counted about 14 different patterns, which have to do with composition, color, brightness, but also visual communication, also changes in content. And I'm just going to highlight one of these patterns, right? So you can see that in the beginning, it's pictures of people, and we're all living people, right? We're politicians, you know, maybe our kind of celebrities, right, of 1920s. So we're particular people, right? So it's photographic portraits. We can also see how color gradually comes in. It takes, you know, maybe 10, 20 years for color to be fully used because color was expensive at first. And then when we get to 2000s, what we can see is about 60% of the covers still represent particular people. So we have portraits, But the other 40% are compositions, illustrations, right, of particular issues, which are, you know, represented in the main articles. So you have this kind of gradual change, right, from portraits to portraits and illustrations of concepts, but it's not, it doesn't happen overnight. In fact, when you look back at the visualization of the whole data set, this change, but also practically every other change, right? There's about 14 different changes here, gradually. So this change, for example, in content, takes place over, you know, the whole 86 years, right? Or 8 years. The other changes, you know, in color or contrast may take place over, you know, 5 years, a few years, right? And that's, and this project illustrates what I think is the single most important reason to use computers to analyze culture, including visual culture. When we use natural languages, you know, English, German, you know, Mandarin, those categories in the world, right? So the language is a kind of semiotic system, right, or a medium, which is about imposing discrete categories, you know, table, this chair, that table, or genre categories, you know, still lifes, landscape, and so on. Whereas the computers, right, which are basically just machines to do math, in data visualization, presenting numbers, it's a different semiotic system, it's a different medium, right? It's a medium which has been adopted by science, calculus, Cartesian coordinates, since the 17th century. This is how science studies the natural world and biological world, and now also social world. It studies us in terms of continuities, small changes, gradual changes, right? And visualization, you know, if you don't like math, if you don't like formulas, if you don't like statistics, visualization is a different way to do the same thing, right? So it basically reveals that the changes are gradual. And it's very important for our history, because our history basically uses the same tool we use in everyday life, which is language. So it's never adapted mathematics, geometry, you know, calculus, visualization. And because it uses natural language, right? And it also comes from 19th century, which was obsessed with classification, right? Our historians like to divide things into periods, right? For example, we have genres. We also have time periods, you know, Renaissance, Baroque, you know, turn of the century, modernism, postmodernism. In reality, you know, culture doesn't change overnight, right? Nothing changes overnight, unless you have something dramatic when Lenin and his bunch of terrorists, you know, take over, right, power in Russia in 1917. But even in Russia, you know, things didn't really change, right? All society existed, but culture doesn't change overnight, right? You grow very gradually. So the main reason, right, to me, was the most important reason to use computers, which is basically machines to do math and statistics, or data visualization, is to be able to represent culture, cultural history, right? The stylistic changes, changes in content, iconography, but also, let's say, the difference between interest, right, between different images, between styles, in terms of continuous changes, in terms of clusters, in terms of fuzzy boundaries, as opposed to discrete categories. So I kind of dwelt a bit on this visualization, because I think it's a kind of good illustration of this main idea. Okay. Even, of course, what you can also do, right, you can also, as I said, right, visualization, it's a kind of different way to do math. You can also measure with computers properties of images, right? So here we use the same data set of this 4,535 covers, and we have measured the average saturation of every image, right? You guys, since you guys are interested in images, you know that there are a few ways to represent image information with RGB. There's also hue, saturation, brightness. So saturation means the intensity of color. So we have measured the average intensity of color for every cover, and then we plotted it as a kind of scatter plot. But we call this image plot because we superimpose images on top of a point. So that's scatter plot of images. And the time on the x-axis from 1923 going all the way to the right to 2009. And then the position of each cover vertically is determined by its saturation, right? So the covers which are most colorful on top, the covers which are, you know, least colorful at the bottom, right? So here are some close-ups, you know, intense covers. You can see that the most intense pure color was red. And it was reserved for kind of dangerous subjects, like powerful females and communists. Right? So communists and females were what readers of Times were really afraid of. And again, here what you can see is that things change very gradually. And also, if you look at the kind of width of the stream, at any point, it allows you to think visually about the basic statistical concept of, you know, variation, right? How spread is your data? So you find that at the top, like in the middle of the 1960s, there's a big spread, right? There's more creative solutions. And in the 70s, the spread is less, right? So again, you don't need to know statistics or math. You can actually intuitively kind of see these concepts through visualization. And you can think about diversity, right? Or variability of a cultural period, cultural school, right? Any other kind of corpus, right? In our history, visual culture. Okay, so now let's look at using kind of basic visualization. Let's look at another data set. So you know, of course, that in the last few years, dozens of museums have started to share, you know, their collections online. Of course, in most cases, almost all the cases, we don't share images. We only share the kind of data about their images, about their artworks, or the data of exhibitions. For example, one good data set for you to try, you can find it, I think, online. So MoMA has a little data set, which is just a spreadsheet of all the exhibitions which ever took place in MoMA. So that's a great data set to do something cool, like in a couple of hours. So we invited to MoMA to work to basically see how we can use visualization of MoMA collection. And we were able to get access to a larger part of our photo collection, which is 21,000 photographs. And eventually, we wrote essay for them, which we published. But, you know, we did about 60 to 80 visualizations just to explore the data set. So what you have here, this is a close-up. You have 20,000 photographs from MoMA collection, which are organized by year. So each row corresponds to year. And so it's a, in a way, it's like a bar plot. It's like a bar plot, except it's made of images, so you get more information. And now you can see why museums never really show you that kind of stuff. They never tell you what's inside. Because once you know what's inside, you realize that all these collections are incredibly biased, in a sense with some periods, some nations, right, some languages are represented better. So here, like, you know, 1889 on the top, even it goes down to, 1884 is on the top, it goes down to 150 years to 1989. And you can see that, you know, the representation of history of photography is very unequal. Photographs are between the wars, between the First and Second World War. So you have this huge wedge. And then we have a little bit from our periods. And then, of course, if you zoom in on this visualization, you can see that mostly it's not newspaper photography. It's not, you know, it's not popular photography. You know, it's a kind of a sort of professional, like artistic photography. And right, so it's very modernist and lots of female bodies, of course. I mean, lots of still lives, right? Maholinash, you know, Rodchenko, people like this. So it's a very particular, take on photography. And of course, we kind of know that, but when you actually see the whole collection together, right, how extreme is this bias is, right? And that's like another important theoretical principle, which we follow in all our projects. If possible, right, look at everything together, right? Look at all the images from New York Times, from look at all the covers of New York Times together at once. From MoMA photo collection at once. Look at all the paintings of Van Gogh at once. Because when you go to exhibitions, right, when you use contemporary search interfaces, right, like which Google gives you, when you go to a museum website, we don't show everything at once. We just show you things which correspond to a particular search term. Here's all photographs by Man Ray. Here's all photographs from 1950. Able to get the data yourself and look at everything together, you start seeing all kinds of important and interesting patterns, which you never see if you only look at parts of a collection. So this is another example of the same approach. So this is one of visualizations I created for about 5,000 paintings of a French impressionist. So by French impressionist, I simply mean artists who participated in 13 impressionist exhibitions. So this is a close-up. And you'll see, you know, typical paintings, which is what people think about when we think about Impressionism, right? They're very light, they're very kind of have lots of brush strokes of pure colors. You know, it's a representation of kind of modern life, right? Modern subjects, the city, but also outside, the outings. But normally, right, in all the, you know, exhibitions, websites, catalogs, what people reproduced are, let's say, most important, right? The kind of, let's say, the masterpieces. So if you look at everything this group of artists produced, you get a very different idea about Impressionism, right? And both ideas are right, right? So when you think about a particular cultural period, a cultural school, you can say, well, we're only interested in the best these people produced. What was important historically, because these paintings were really innovative, but equally valid way to look, for example, at Impressionism is to say, well, let's look at everything. And what you'll see is that Impressionism, which is how like your students, right, or normal people think about Impressionism, is maybe only 30 or 40% of our output. And in fact, the rest of it are much more traditional paintings. They're dark, right? We represent more traditional subjects. So only a small part of what Impressionism produced is in fact modern. So now let's expand the size of our data set. This is one visualization from a project we have done in 2010. So we collected, so now we'll start looking at modern visual culture. So one of them, maybe three or four, right, most popular cultural forms today. It's not visual art, right? It's manga, right? It's Japanese and Korean comics. So we downloaded 1 million manga pages, which is a pretty large sample of global manga. And we, you know, work on it. This is kind of visualization with 1 million pages, which, you know, uses plot. And the pages are organized by certain visual characteristics, right? Using basic tools from, image processing, computer vision, right? So here we have close-ups, kind of cloud visualization of big image plots, right? So these close-ups correspond to the top, right? The top corner of this cloud and the right bottom corner. Right? We have opposite kind of visual styles, right? So on the top, we have images which are very detailed, very textured, some in color, but we couldn't render it because it's so big. It takes more work, it takes more labor to render things, because until recently manga was all kind of done by hand. And then for bottom we have things which are more, let's say, minimal, more black and white, less detail, no 3D. And again, right, if we use the traditional kind of humanities tool, which is natural language, we'll have a tendency to divide this into styles. We can say here's one style, here's another style. Right? Because if you look at this particular visualization, and of course, there are other differences, right, between manga pages. So from certain points of view, if you look at the iconography, how we represent the tiers, there are probably distinct styles. But if you look at this particular dimension, which is, you know, texture, 3D, detail, versus no texture, no 3D, no detail, it's a completely continuous change, right? It's a completely continuous distribution. And try to divide it into styles, it'll be completely meaningless. So once again, what we'll see is that just as well language almost kind of forces us to look at the world and to look at culture in terms of discrete categories, when we're using the computer tools, they allow us, or maybe you can say forces, right, to look at things in terms of continuity. And because we haven't really had these tools, right, until recently, right, we couldn't really measure things, we couldn't really visualize 1 million images, right, in one visualization, it's a very refreshing, right? So it makes sense for the next 10, 20, 30 years, right, for humanities to kind of fully adopt computational methods, because what we get is not just simply another tool, we get a different way of seeing culture, right? Seeing the data, seeing the world. In terms of continuity, to continuous change as opposed to discrete categories. Let me skip this one because we don't have much time. Maybe we'll do this one. So then in 2013, we said, okay, great. So now we kind of figure out what we're doing. You know, we built some software tools, you know, which are available to you. Like, you know, you can download them from our lab website. I'm sure Harold will show you where we are, image plot, image montage. So we said, now let's actually study what I want to study, which is contemporary visual culture. And one good place to see contemporary visual culture is Instagram. So we did about 6 or 7 projects using millions of Instagram images. So that was our first project, where we kind of downloaded over 2.5 million images from Instagram, which was shared in the spring of 2012. So it's very early histogram, right? It's a kind of like a, you know, early Renaissance histogram, so to speak. Now I think we have like Baroque histogram, right? So it was all downloaded on a single laptop, but it took a few months. And then we started to apply the same visualization techniques to kind of measure simple visual properties, and then visualize images where we're sorted by these properties. And here, of course, we realized that our tools are very limited because, you know, if you look at time covers, we have lots of structure, right? We're all the same size, we all have word of time, we show people. So if you have a kind of visual data set which has lots of structure, right? You can look at the change over time of a single property, for example, and it's gonna be very meaningful. But Instagram has everything, right? Every kind of photography, every kind of like art style. And when you measure it using the simple tools, right, it does look very interesting. So in this visualization, we have 50,000 images from San Francisco and 50,000 images from Tokyo, and they're sorted by average brightness, right? And then average hue, you know, and we don't learn much, right? I mean, basically, we don't really see much difference between the cities, between visual culture of Instagram and the cities, except what we notice, there is not much blue and there is not much green, right? So we're definitely cities and people don't really look at the sky too much, but that's all. But then, for example, you know, we take these data sets and we visualize them differently, right? So here we compare New York City on the top and Tokyo, and the it's 50,000 images which we shared over a few days continuously, and we simply sorted by date and time when we shared. You can actually start seeing that every city had its own visual rhythm, right? With dark and light patterns correspond to day and night, right? So it's like a kind of like a collective film made about director, right, by thousands of Instagram users. And these rhythms, you know, they reflect, you know, routines, right? There's certain patterns in the life of the cities, but also every day, right? Every night is different, right? So every one of these kind of parts of this kind of sine wave is different, right? And also we can see that the days in New York City last longer because people were, in a way, what it means is that people share more images within the same day, right? Close up. And what's important to me, right, about these visualizations, which we call media visualizations, so direct visualizations, is that we don't reduce cultural data to points or lines. We represent cultural artifacts, i.e. images, as images, because every image is a world, right? Every image is not a point, and you're able to see much more, and also understand what is the reason for a pattern you see, right? For example, here you understand that the night on Instagram is not completely dark, right? Because people keep sharing images of meals or images of like being inside or also images of some vacations they want to take, right? So for example, the night on Instagram is different in every city. Now, you can go on, right? And you can use kind of basic data science. And data science, I think, in this context means automatically measuring other properties of images or also using, for example, metadata. So we can, for example, include metadata, how many likes each image got, right? How much it was shared, when it was shared. So here we measured about 60 different properties of these images. And then we aggregated these properties for each city and using a very basic data science technique called multidimensional scaling, which was invented in the 50s. We did this two-dimensional plot, which basically tries to represent visual differences between Instagram images, you know, shared in the cities. And the point about these plots is, of course, depending on what parameters you use and what features you measure, you can get endless amount of plots. So what you get is not one interpretation, but you get multiple interpretations of your data set. And that's another very important idea, right? That's another very important theoretical reason to hack, right, our history and to use data analysis and visualization, is that you multiply number of interpretations. And then you'll see which ones, you know, are meaningful. But, you know, maybe every person may like different interpretation, right? So it's about kind of opening interpretive field as opposed to generating one correct interpretation. So here we're looking at all the features. Here we're looking only at colors. And we can see that depending if we're looking only at colors, or if we're also looking at structure, you know, composition, so on, the positions of the cities are different, but with a certain similarity, right? So Bangkok is the most different, and then Singapore, and then Tokyo, right? So the Asian cities are really different. And even though here the positions have changed, right? In general, Bangkok and Singapore are still, right, are still the outliers. So let's see. So now I will show you kind of two more things, which was the next steps in the development of our work. So we started, I was able to get a big grant, which allowed me to hire a top visualization designer and a kind of software developer, amazing talents, to cultural data sets. And here we wanted to create not just simply create static visualizations or animations, we wanted to create a new interface to exploring visual culture, right? And that's maybe in our, right? So for me, cultural analytics is not simply analyzing cultural data, visualizing cultural data, interpreting. It's also creating interfaces which can be used by students, by experts, but can be also used by anybody to explore, right, patterns in visual culture. Because right now, if you want to understand, okay, what images people share on the web, what images people share on Pinterest, what images people share on Instagram, well, you know, you can search, right, for particular titles. You can go by category. You can search for what's shared in a particular city. But the search is only going to mean, right, you know, you're not going to go and look at billions of images. And there are 2 billion images being shared every day today, right? So what we need is we need to invent new interfaces which are appropriate to study visual culture at a new scale, where today people probably upload on Flickr more images in one day than all the artworks, right, ever discussed by all our historians in our history classes, right? You know, and you can say, well, when people discuss our history are like masterpieces or canons, when people share on Flickr is, you know, whatever. But I think it's a wrong, right? It's a kind of wrong perspective, because when we go to archaeological museum, we have to find equivalents of Twitter posts, right, or Flickr images. We basically find some remainders of some pots, right, you know, and our kind of everyday objects, and that's how we know about civilization, right? That's what we have left from human civilization from 3,000-5,000 years ago. Anthropological perspective, which looks at the whole culture and considers every instance, every cultural artifact, every value, right? In more humanities perspective, which kind of traditionally was only looking at particular canons, which is what was created by professional elites, for elites, right? Such as professional 19th century, 18th century artists, it's basically art for elites, as opposed to looking at everything, as opposed to looking at visual culture, right? If you adopt this perspective, you know, when every image on Flickr or Instagram is equally interesting to us. So we did kind of, so in one case, the data we used was Instagram selfies. Now, I know it's a very well-known topic today, but that was very early. We actually started working this in the summer of 2013. And the project was released in January of 2014. So it's actually 3 years ago, exactly. So here we use also computer vision to measure characteristics of selfies. And again, today you have maybe 20 or so APIs, which allow you to measure characteristics of faces. At that point, we had one. And then this is a kind of static visualization, a static image plot, which compares distribution of selfie photos between 5 cities in terms of kind of gender, right? So females are on the upper part of each visualization, males on the bottom. I mean, images are sorted by basically measurement of happiness. Now, of course, there are lots of questions about, right? What does it mean the computer measures happiness? Is it going to measure happiness in the same way? Because maybe people express happiness differently in different cultures. So there are always questions, right? Which became clear to us after we did the project. But nevertheless, you know, this is what we did. So you can see that there is more kind of smiling people in Bangkok and São Paulo and not so many in Moscow. Of course, now I regularly go to Moscow and I find actually people kissing the streets more than, you know, Paris or Berlin or So actually, people are very kind of contemporary, very happy young people. But, you know, we just don't smile in the same way which we used to train this computer vision program, right? So when we did this interface, which is what I want to show you, so that was our attempt, right, to create a new type of interface for exploring image collection, which happened to be selfies, but could be anything else, where we kind of we can have a media exploration, media navigation of a collection. At the bottom, we can have statistical graphs, and the graph will show you metadata on the top, and you can filter data set by graphs. So it's like, in a way, it's like a search, but because you were searching like a very small database, it was about less than 4,000 images, right? You can actually understand the place of every kind of pattern across the whole database, right? So we have a little video, which I will play, which kind of shows you this interface, but it even works on a mobile phone. So if you go to selfiecity.net, and you can click on the selfie exploratory, you'll be able to explore it yourself. Okay. Okay, so I will show you the last thing. So then the next thing we did is working with the same team. We said, let's now make a different interface. So again, it's also interface for exploration of cultural data. But rather than looking at a particular genre of images, which is self-portraits, we said, let's look at a different type of a kind of, let's say, cultural social phenomenon, which is digital city. And by digital city, I mean, right, you know, you guys know about, right, computational urban studies and, or, you know, and the use of big data and for urbanism, right, and the fact that Uber has released like data on 2 billion rides, which is used by cities to, let's say, to maybe, you know, and the whole science of cities. But this is all very analytical, statistical, science-like approaches, right? So we wanted to create an interface which would be very visual, intuitive, which would represent a city, right? Is layers of data, both data kind of shared and also maybe data, right, shared by devices. So we're using, you know, 22 million taxi rides along Broadway Street in New York in 2013. We were able to get this data and also maybe data collected, right, by city government. It was a commission for New York Public Library. It was shown as installation for 40 months. This is, you know, the key team. Our design interface, so it uses about 14 different data layers. And the data layers are aligned, you know, to a horizontal line. So it actually doesn't represent the whole city, it only represents Broadway. So it's one street which crosses New York, like a kind of X, like think of it as a kind of like axis, right? Like a coordinate. And we have images which we downloaded because it has API from Google Street View. We started facade colors, we have statistics about use of taxis, we have social media statistics, you know, how many Foursquare check-ins, Twitter, Instagram, images people shared in a particular part. We also have statistics from census data, like such as average income. And we have Instagram photos, which people shared, right, at each point along Broadway. So we basically divided Broadway, which is 22 kilometers, into like 700 plus little rectangles. Each rectangle was 30 meter long, because this is how often the Google Street View takes cars take their images. And then the interface was presented on a kind of big touch screen. And you'll see, I will play a video that using kind of familiar language of touch gestures, you can zoom out and see these patterns, you know, in a single visualization for a whole 22 kilometer of a street. Or you can zoom in, even navigate the city kind of building by building, block by block. The video, which kind of shows you the navigation. Now, we do have application, but it only works on big screens and very fast computers because it was really designed as installation. So again, when you zoom out, you see everything. And when you can zoom in, and now you can navigate with, you know, kind of building by building. And you can see this statistics in the middle, which tells you like how much media or how much income or how many taxes people take, right, in this particular area. But the images dominate, right? So the top layer is the Google Street View. And it was like another attempt, right, to combine, let's say, classical language of data visualization, which represents data as kind of numbers, lines, points. And then what we call media visualization, which is basically making new compositions from the actual media people share. Because as I said, right, the image is not a data point. Every image is a world. So when they start applying computational and digital methods in our history, right, we still want to be looking at images, you know, historical records, sculptures, etc. So I think I will kind of stop here. So that was actually about 40 minutes, exactly as you ordered. And I hope maybe we can have a few questions. Thank you.
Yes, thank you for the presentation. For at first, for the inspiring talk. And if you stop the screencast, we can see you again.
Yeah, exactly. So it's just to see how they. Okay, I have to figure out how to stop it. You know how to stop it? It's a screen share. I don't know how to stop it.
There you are.
You stop now. Okay.
Now we can see.
Okay. Yeah. Great.
Question.
Okay.
To left.
So I hope you can hear me. Okay. But I was actually very happy with the lecture because, you know, normally like I can't do as much stuff in 40 minutes and actually talk about theoretical topics. So I'm actually, so somehow even though your audience somehow gave me good energy. You know, so, but maybe you haven't heard anything.
Let me say it first that you've shown a few videos and they are probably all online, and we will share your links that you have shown with everyone. We also put up a list of tools, and I will also put on that list that everyone can take a look at it. And we have been talking today a lot about visualizations, about interfaces, about users, and so on. And I think you have touched all of those subjects. So I'm sure there are a lot of questions in the audience. And if you could come here to the microphone, that would hear those questions in over there. So what are your questions, please?
Oh, come on, guys! Don't be shy. I don't bite.
Yeah. Here's someone who you can hear.
He has the Andreas voice. Can you hear me?
No. Yes.
Please, the best thing is to come here.
Okay. This is dangerous. Hello. So. My question is, with the visualizations that you do in the installations, what kind of response do you get from people? How are they understanding the data differently as the result of this type of interface?
Well, I think, you know, it's impossible, right? Impossible to answer since we're, you know, since we put all the projects online, so we're thousands of people. But I think But let me answer it more theoretically, right? There are two points here, which I think are very important for like digital rights history or whatever, right? Whatever it is we're doing. So, okay, so one thing we can say, we can take existing kind of cultural, I don't know, data, right? Which I think which people have already studied, wrote books, you know, Impressionism, you know? I don't know, Van Gogh, right? 1960s pop art, right? Whatever. And then we can say, okay, can we basically, if we measure things, if we visualize things, if we sort things, you know, can we come up with, or can we just see patterns, right, which we haven't seen before? And I was just about to show you, but then like I hit 40 minutes. For example, if you apply our tools to something very canonical, like a career of Van Gogh, you also see very different things, right? So that's one thing. But then there's a second thing where we have this explosion, right, of culture, right? Right, where, you know, and not just images and video, but whereas websites, where interactive interfaces, right? You know, there's motion graphics, you know, we have like meetings, right? We have symposia, we have explosion of culture. And part of this explosion involves cultural fields which are all about 20 years old. Like interaction design, web design, you know, or like mobile photography. And because these fields like emerged very recently, we actually don't know much about them, right? So we don't know like who like 5 million most important Instagram photographers, right? And we'll never know because things keep expanding. So that's, I think, the second reason, right, to use computational and visualization tools is to explore the kind of cultural fields and cultural domains which are more recent, which are so massive, where we don't have like 1,000 articles of our historian, right? We don't know the canon, and that's a good thing because maybe we don't want to start with canon, we actually want to see what are the trends, right? And I would say that, you know, I'm interested in both. I'm interested in both. I think both, right? Both are, unfortunately, what I found is that the first thing, it's actually easier, right? Because, you know, we know a lot about Impressionism. So we know like what the different interpretations are. And also, let's say 5,000 paintings, Impressionists only created like 13,000 paintings and pastels. So if you look at 5,000 paintings, you see things right away, right? If I start looking at millions of Instagram photos, they're so diverse, right? It's much more challenging. But ultimately, I think that this ultimately to me, it's a contemporary visual culture with its speed, variety, right? And connectivity, which ultimately justifies the need for computer tools because you can't really see it, right, in any other ways. But when we started doing our work, we found that even if you apply these tools to like a small data set of, you know, few dozen artworks, you can still find new things, right? So it's a kind of, so in a way I see it as a tool related but kind of separate goals, right? Yeah. And the last thing I want to say, so I think I know I haven't really illustrated this properly but I think I kind of made the key point, right? But one of the key consequences of using statistics, mathematics, calculus, or visualization is that it's a different language which allows you to see things which have continuities, right? And small differences as opposed to kind of big categories. So if you apply this to Van Gogh, right, you say, oh my God, he doesn't really have periods which correspond to where he lived. It actually continues change, right? So in a way, right, so the point I'm trying to make, just as the language, right, we can language forces you to see things in one way. When we have mathematics, computers, and visualization, we can force you and we enable you to see things in different ways, right? So if you apply computers, like, you know, it's very easy to see continuities and gradual change everywhere, right? Kind of discovery you will make, but you will not make our type of discovery, right? So it also has its limits. Okay, thank you. Like people have to come, it's like exam, you guys have to come, you know.
Just sit here.
Okay. Yeah, so I wanted, especially for Instagram, for things like that, there's lots of things like filters where, if you like, these mostly American businesses imply some very strict visual restrictions, which presumably show up in things like, you know, color plots and visualization plots. Mm-hmm. One of the big problem of looking at translation. If you try and look for translated documents online, so many are already translated by machines. Does YouTube find the same thing with if you like, images that humans make, that actually you see, yes, the kinds of things that people are taking photographs of, but maybe to a greater extent, the kinds of different visualizations that are being imposed on them. So I don't know, some particular Philo-American countries use American filters more often and so on and so forth.
Sure. Well, so I think two points, right? So one point is that when I first thought about these possibilities, like which was 12 years ago, right? I think I was very excited about the idea, how do we look at 1 billion images, right? And what do we see? Now, I realized, right, because I think the web has been changing, the social media has been changing, right? Instagram was first not used by businesses, I mean, around 2014, 2015, it started to use by big companies, especially fashion companies, right? And there is also obviously like millions of YouTube videos, like how to theme it, right? You know, it's still, like, I mean, I haven't shown it to you, but we basically analyzed 16 million Instagrams in our lab. We found out that 99% are very casual photos by normal people. We don't even apply filters, or we don't really care about how things look, right? So in fact, this more structured, right, this more engineered Instagrams, you know, it's a small part, but it's a part which is most visible because that's what newspapers write about. So of course, what also interests me is to study how this, let's say, rules, conventions, right, kind of filters, metaphorically, how they emerge, right? So for example, does something like Instagram, is there less variability, is there less diversity of content, techniques, styles today than 3 years ago? And I think to study this, we really need computers, right? Because we need to be able to measure certain things across billions of images. So definitely, we want to understand, right? Because with this kind of platforms like Instagram, right? But also Facebook or Twitter, you know, we impose particular restrictions, right? Like for example, you can like or not like, right? In the beginning, Instagram, all images had to be square. And it's a very interesting theoretical questions for visual culture and media studies, right? What is the role of these restrictions? But every medium imposes restrictions, right? So I think I should finish, but you know, it's super interesting. But the only thing I can say practically, so when we did our first Instagram project in 2013, we're actually using Instagram API. So we downloaded with 2.5 million images, and for every image, we also got like a filter, right? So we found out what filter it uses. And since then, there are a few papers by computer scientists which also look at user filters because we look at certain cities. So we have this graph, which is like frequency of filter use per city. It's almost exactly the same between different cities, right? So the big difference is that in some cities, only 30% of images were filtered. Other cities was almost 50%. But in terms of filters, it was kind of the same. And when we look at this frequency, right, it almost perfectly corresponded to the order, right? To the order of buttons, or filter button Instagram interface, right? So this is a perfect example. And I wish, right? I mean, I'm hoping to do more projects which we can look at this, because I think that's, of course, very interesting, right? It's behaviors. On the one hand, we have explosion of this kind of culture, like, you know, like where people create cultural objects now, like atoms. On the other hand, right? People follow each other, there's mimicry, there's always how-to videos. And how do these processes, right, of interact? Like, what are the conventions? Because now these conventions or ways to edit, right? You have applications. So that's very, very interesting. But I don't think it's something we can do, you guys can do in one day, but it will be very interesting. Will be interesting projects to do it. And I'm hoping to do it in the future in some kind of more systematic way. So absolutely, right? Now, I just want to say, I don't know. I mean, I know that, of course, America genius, right? It's not culture, American genius is business. So American companies, you know, and also small companies, individuals have been very aggressive in like kind of commercializing things like Instagram and Snapchat. I wonder if it's only American companies today, right? So that of course would be another interesting question, which nobody looked at, right? Yeah.
Thanks.
Sure, great.
one is coming. Here we are.
Hello. Can you hear me?
Yes. But I'm feeling so sad now, right? Such an amazing, amazing gathering. And you all ask really good questions, and you're also energetic. You know, if I showed up, we could have done like 10 projects in one day. So, and I have to stay here and finish the idiotic book because that's what universities want from you, books. But anyway, but I want to say, look, I'm around. I will watch your lectures. You guys can send me emails anytime. I'm online the whole day. You can also chat to me. Like, think of me as a kind of virtual participants, because also talking to you really motivates me to like finish the book, you know. So I'm getting lots from you. So I'll be around the whole week.
Okay,
you know?
So last okay, question.
Yes.
My question is, since works like soft cinema to on Broadway, like you told us, when you first pictured, what would be these visualizations? What gap to the final interface that you have now? When you first imagined what this could be, it was like this, like you presented, or there was a huge
difference? Yes. Okay. Harold, can I show? Is it okay if I show you images? It's okay if I show something, no? Because I want to show you, I designed. We designed, like when we set up a lab, like we got money to set up a lab in 2007, so like 10 years ago. And the first thing we did, we got to design like this kind of ideal, or like the right interface to study contemporary visual culture. And what we were able to realize is like 0.001% of its interface, right? So in a way, what we've done, we kind of invented what's now called like social media dashboards. Was supposed mm-hmm. to run on these huge visualization walls because I had access to these walls at my university in California. And, you know, what I'll do is, I don't want to take time. I will send a few links to you guys and you can look at them. So the idea was to have this like 10-minute long interface, which is like a media dashboard. So except you can like zoom in into any point, like any city in the world and see what people share there, show you statistics, right? So what is the content being shared in that city, how it relates to content being shared in the whole continent, etc. So one thing would be like geographic interface. Actually, like all Instagram images, like a long tail, into likes. So you're actually looking at millions of images. And then the third interface would be like a map of science, where you would actually see there's a particular field, I know, like graphic design. And maybe you say, well, Capita has identified 800 styles in graphic design. You have this network, right? And you'll be able to switch between screens. So I was inspired by some interfaces, which now cities have. Like, so cities have interfaces to look at the city data, you know, big companies have. But as I said, now we have a genre of like, right, like Hootsuite, you know, Sprout, the social media dashboards. But we all very low resolution, we only measure text. But you know, if somebody would give me a couple million dollars, we could have a couple of programs. We can get it done now, maybe even for 6 months. The problem is that you have to maintain it all the time, right? Because APIs change. So when you think about the teams, which are responsible for this kind of social media tools today, it's a big team because things change over time, right? So I think that you know what I showed you are just like tiny, tiny pieces. Because what I actually got interested later, I said, okay, so that's great. But can we actually, how we can actually analyze not just the data across the world, but historical data, and how do we also visualize patterns of creations, like for example, overpaintings by artists, you know, and then we kind of zoomed out. So I think on Broadway was our most ambitious attempt. So it uses about 40 million, right? 40 million data points and images, but it's not real time, right? So it took us 6 months to collect the data, and then 3 months to organize it, right? So it's not real time, right? But I think again, it's possible to do it in real time, but you just need to have like a grant, you just need to have like you know, I don't know, half a million, or maybe with all you guys we can do it in 1 week. But it will take because the techniques are getting better and better, right? So the computer vision is getting better and better. So the techniques, you know, you can put stuff on Amazon, right? But the problem is that once you do it, you would have to maintain it, right? And it's not real time, but actually using data sets which we already collected, which we already analyzed. But in theory, you know, within the next 5 years, I mean, even now, you can do this in real time, right? But can I just say one thing? It's another theoretical point. Harold, can I? So this is what I learned in 10 years. So 10 years ago, I was super excited about this. You know, and I thought, great, you know, we can just take millions of, you know, images of graphic design and, like, you know, use vision and machine learning and figure out, okay, this is 100 different styles in modern design, right? Or this is 200 different kind of styles in modern photography. Well, so we can do it, we can do kind of now, but what I realize is this. Let's say we take a photograph or a painting, whatever you want. The computer can say, I identify the content of this photograph or painting. Here's a person, here's a tree, here's this. The computer can measure colors. So the computer can measure like 500 things from this image. And not account for the impression you get why this image is interesting, because your brain processes this image differently, right? So somehow these features are glued, right, in the cortex. And also what I realized, what separates, for example, a great photographer is like this last 1%, this amazing kind of choices on these small dimensions, which nobody even knows about, only they know, right? So while the computer can probably get like, you know, 80 or 90% of the content or style of an image, what really may matter is the last 5%, right? So the point which I want to say is that, of course, every data analysis, every statistic is always reduction. It's reducing, right? You're reducing, let's say, an image which may have like 3 million pixels to 500 features or to a point in the graph. And while it allows you to see certain patterns, right? So we can see, for example, the pattern of how Van Gogh becomes brighter, becomes more saturated, right? There's always going to be other things which this reduction is going to miss. Right, so it's very, very useful. I think the examples which I showed you, I think we all show you how you can actually see, you can see things with computers, right? You can see certain things, like the distribution of images at MoMA, right? But in terms of actually getting to the next level, right, after you did all the easy stuff, which will maybe take another 25 years, but after that, the next 25 years will be really, really hard. Because when you can run across the limits of artificial intelligence, but ultimately computer, if the computer really understands the image, it's hard on me, right? Well, I don't know that much. Maybe like hard, right? So the computer can just measure things, but it doesn't see things. But because we never really measured things in our history, with lots of like easy hanging fruits, right? So people who will do it, I think, will do amazing stuff for the next 5, 10, 20 years, but after that it will get kind of hard, right? Because then we'll deal with hard things, right? So I'm very optimistic about it, but I'm also, I think, a bit more realistic about it than 10 years ago, because I realized what computers can do, and I also realized what computers still. Thank you so much. And I do hope that you guys will reach out to me. Again, I'm like sitting in my home working on the book. I'm online, so you can just reach out to me on Google Chat, you know, whatever. And I will try to watch your lectures. And if you're analyzing something and questions about using our tools or anything else, please reach out, because I want to be part of your amazing team. Thank you so much.
Very good. We appreciate that. Yes, we'll get in contact with you again as soon as we have questions. But I can say that has been inspiring. And maybe one very last short question is,
Sure.
What would be your recommendation for us as a group, how we can accomplish until Friday? Do you think there's a possibility to manage that? What would be your recommendation for us?
Well, I mean, I can only tell you what I found useful, right, in my practice, my classes, right? So normally we work on our projects in groups. It can be 2 people, 3 people, 4 people, 5 people. Because it's just easier. I mean, it's good if every group has like one kind of technical person, right, who can do things. Of course, maybe it's also useful to put a few technical people together, because we can really kind of hack the hell out of it. But let me tell you something else. And this is maybe very tricky. I will tell you something really secret. So you're going to be working with like data which is available on European, right? Here's what I found. You know, it's like, you know, if you're doing makeup, right? You know, you will use particular tools, right? If I'm doing my nails, I'm using particular tools. If I'm going to put nail on the wall, I'm going to use. So every tool is good for certain things, not for other things. So what I found, we did maybe 45, 50 projects, I mean, of different scale in our lab in 12 years. What I found like this, if you have a data set, not a very big one, which actually has a very strong pattern, it has a very strong patterns, maybe differences in terms of different parts of a data set or changes time to reveal those patterns. When you can get something done interesting, like, you know, in 5 minutes. If you have a data set which doesn't have strong patterns, you can spend 2 years, you'll never get anything out of it, right? So don't be seduced by the size of data you can get. Think about kind of parts, right? Think about parts of the data from European or other sources where you actually already know that you'll do something interesting. So it's a dirty trick, right? So, like, I know Van Gogh, right? I mean, or I know, like, Mondrian, right? We know how Mondrian's style changed very dramatically from, like, realism to more abstract, even to his kind of this branded things. So the moment you visualize Mondrian, you'll get something interesting because you'll see this style change, right? So if you want to make something, like, quickly and be satisfied, start with a data set which corresponds to cultural phenomena which actually you know something about, and you actually already know that there are some strong patterns there, right? And I want to say one thing. So to me, there's a big, big issue with all this digital archives, like Europeana and other stuff, because it's basically like a library, right? Historically, a library was a place where library would collect something, but basically it was a place where individuals would bring their collections, right? So if you look at New York Public Library, right? It's like some surrealistic Borges museum, right? And the European, it's also, right? I actually have a section in my book where, like, I'm a bit making a bit of fun of European. Like, when you basically start browsing, you get always this chair from 18th century, always this, like, letter from 19th century. It's like this, all these little pieces. It's always little sample points from human cultural history. But what you want to do is you want to get the islands from this data which are coherent. So here's the 5,000 engravings from Germany from 1860s, right? Here's 500 posters, I don't know, from 1968 from France, right? You want to get islands which are coherent, because then you can actually see some patterns, right? If you have, like, all kinds of sample points which correspond to different media, different authors, different places, and also lots of them are just like, it's just records, it's just like random records, like as though aliens came, it just randomly sampled the human history. You can't do anything useful with it, right? You know, the only thing you can do is reveal what's inside Europeana. What's inside culture, you have to find these islands of coherence, right? And this is something I'm very, very kind of convinced, because that's experienced many, many times, right? And I don't know what's possible, maybe it's challenging, but if there is like 50 million records inside, there are probably things, right? But what you don't want to do, you don't want to work, for example, let's say we want to work on Rembrandt. We have 20 Rembrandt paintings and 30 Rembrandt letters and 20 Rembrandt engravings, just this kind of beauty. Like, what do you do with it, right? So you want to find something which is coherent in terms of time period, place, medium. Even you can look at patterns inside this thing. Again, I don't know European intimately. I was actually a keynote speaker at our event a year and a half ago in Austria. So maybe, I mean, it's changing, but that's one advice, right? Find some islands where a certain cultural phenomena with sufficient density, right? With sufficient resolution. Does this make sense?
Yes.
Yes? Yes.
I think so. Yeah.
So I'll be very curious. Yeah, I'll be very curious to see what you guys find there, like what you find which you can use that quickly to do something. Yeah. Yeah.
Very good. We keep you up to date about what we will do here. And we thank you very much for your time, and we hope you get back to writing your book, because we are very curious to read it, of course, as soon as it's out. Thank you much for your time, and it has been an input here. And tomorrow we will form such groups and take a look at tools, including maybe image plot, and we will see what comes out of that. So thank you very much.
I will send. I will send you an email because the image plot in image montage, which is actually more useful. We exist different places, so we write code is on GitHub. So I will send you a link. And just remember, but image montage is actually more useful. There are lots of tools here. We just need like smart ways of using them. And basically, we need to find good data sets. And then it just works by itself, you know. So that's a trick. Okay, thank you guys, and I hope you stay in touch. Thank you for your questions, and I'm mentally with you. Except I can't go drinking with you, so I'm sorry about that. But bye for now. So, cheers.
Thank you very much.